I'd like to say congratulations to all of our graduates. As you move forward in this time of your lives, I want to encourage you to never be ashamed of the love and the peace and the joy that Jesus Christ can bring into our lives. My prayer is that you'll keep growing in your faith every day as it will be tested. Please understand that you can lean on God in any and every situation that comes your way. One of my favorite verses that I was able to cling to in high school, college, and even yet today is Joshua 1:9, and it says this, "Be strong and courageous. Do not be terrified. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go." Wherever God leads you through these next chapters of your life, make sure that you're a difference maker for him. This world needs more young adults making a difference in the name of Jesus, and I strongly believe that you are all capable of doing that if you'll just put your trust in him. Before we get started in our worship today, I would just like to say a prayer. God, thank you for today and another chance to worship you. God, I'm thankful for the relationships I've been able to build with a lot of these graduates, and I thank you for the relationships that are being built with those coming up through our youth group system. God, bless them, be with them, keep them safe as they move to college or move on to high school. And I pray that just through these next chapters that they'll just glorify you with everything that they say and do. Bless our time in worship here today. In your name we pray. Amen.
He's strong enough to say, arise, your shackles are no more, for Jesus Christ has broken every chain. I will call upon the Lord, for He alone is strong enough to save. Arise, your shackles are no more, for Jesus Christ has broken every chain. I searched the world, it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise, treasures that fail, never enough. And you came along, put me back together. Every desire is now satisfied here in your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. There's nothing better than you. There's nothing. Nothing is better than you. You see them all, still call me friend. Cause the God of the mountain, He's the God of the valley. There's not a place for mercy and grace won't find me again. Come on now. Oh, there's nothing better than
to army. You can see.
highways. You're the only one who did. You turned grace into God. You turned bones into armies. You turned seas into highways.
Your name I want to jump on the bandwagon and congratulate all the 2020 graduates along with their parents who are joining us for online worship today, whether you're in middle school, high school, or college. And I know this wasn't exactly how you planned it. Some of you were set to experience the excitement of attending prom or the relief that comes through completing your final exams, receiving a diploma in a packed gym, and celebrating with all your friends and family at a special reception held in your honor. But instead, maybe you had a virtual graduation ceremony, or you walked across the stage in an empty auditorium. Maybe you watched as a parade of vehicles drove by with signs wishing you well. Let me say this, you've got quite a memory to share later in life, don't you? But all of that doesn't change your accomplishments, and it doesn't change how far you've come and how far you're going to go. It doesn't change how proud we are of you. And more important, it doesn't change how pleased God is with you at this point in your life. You know, I did the math, and it's hard for me to believe that I've been out of high school now for 39 years. That was back in the days of leisure suits. Google it, young people. They're coming back. It was wide lapels and bell-bottom pants, and there were platform shoes. You don't realize this, but I was actually 6'2" tall in the 1970s. Anyway, when I say the words high school, I'm sure your mind is flooded with memories that you won't soon forget. For all of us, there are some good memories and some bad. These years likely represent for you either a magical time or maybe a mundane time, or maybe even a miserable time in your life. But regardless of how you feel about that time in your life, I think it's always good to look back. You know, we often hear this expression, and maybe you've used it before, if I knew then what I know now. Ever say that? Ever like to be able to go back and change some of the things that you did to do them differently? Well, today I'm speaking specifically to graduates, but I want to invite everyone to listen because I really believe the things I'll talk about today are beneficial for all believers, no matter where you're at in your stage of life. There are some lessons I've learned along the way that I want to share with you today. Actually, Solomon learned these lessons first, but they're lessons that the spiritually mature will have or should have accepted since their high school days. The text I want to use today is Solomon's Old Testament book of Ecclesiastes. Solomon begins this book by referring to himself as the teacher, which is sort of fitting as we look back on our school days. In the opening of the book, in chapter 1, verses 1 and 2, Solomon says this, "The words of the teacher, son of David, king in Jerusalem, meaningless." Meaningless, says the teacher, utter meaningless. Everything is meaningless. For those of you keeping score, that's four uses of the word meaningless in just two verses. I suspect he's trying to tell us something. You know, someone has explained the book of Ecclesiastes by saying this, "Scripture acknowledges the authentic disillusionment that many people feel after searching fruitlessly for personal fulfillment." And that's where Solomon's at. At the end of his life, he looks back and he says to you and me, here's what I've learned. And it seems to center around this idea that the common thread for most people in life is the search for meaning and purpose. What I want to do real quickly is share some lyrics to two songs with very similar titles, but performed by two very different performers. The first is Christian singer Michael W. Smith, who put these lyrics to music way back in 1990. Here's what he sang, The wind is moving, but I am standing still. A life of pages waiting to be filled. A heart that's hopeful, a head that's full of dreams. But this becoming is harder than it seems. It feels like I'm looking for a reason, roaming through the night to find my place in this world. Not a lot to lean on. I need your light to help me find my place in this world. He writes later in the song, speaking to God, hear me asking, where do I belong? Is there a vision that I can call my own? Show me. Well, then there's country music sensation Taylor Swift, who wrote and performed these lyrics back in 2007. She sang, I don't know what I want, so don't ask me, because I'm still trying to figure it out. Don't know what's down this road, I'm just walking, trying to see through the rain coming down. Even though I'm not the only one that feels the way I do, I'm alone, on my own, and that's all I know. Hear these words, I'll be strong, I'll be wrong, oh, but life goes on. Oh, I'm just a girl trying to find a place in this world. Two very different ideas. But you know what? People are still searching for their place in this world. Maybe that describes you today. And they're looking, believe it or not, in some of the same places that Solomon looked, trying to find meaning and purpose. You know, you could take the book of Ecclesiastes and you could really summarize it in just one sentence. Anything you chase after in this world, that's the key. Anything you chase after in this world will prove to be meaningless. It's just a chasing after the wind. And Solomon should know. As he explains in his book, he pursued all those things that we pursue. He didn't just pursue them, he caught them. Because Solomon was so wealthy, he had every possible pleasure at his fingertips. Solomon had it all, but he found it all to be utterly meaningless. So what I want us to do for the next few moments is look more deeply into these areas of pursuit and see what it is that Solomon discovered. With each attempt, Solomon learned an important lesson, and I want us to learn those lessons as well. The first important lesson learned by Solomon is this: wisdom is more valuable than education. You know, while in school, students work hard to make good grades so they can get into the right college and eventually into the right job, and that's not a bad thing. A good education and learning a trade is important. In fact, it's necessary if you're going to provide for yourself and provide for a family someday. So what is Solomon saying? He just warns of putting an unhealthy emphasis on the endless accumulation of knowledge, just learning things in order to know more things. The wisest man of all, that's Solomon, says that he devoted himself to study and he found it to be a heavy burden. Notice these two passages. In Ecclesiastes 1, verses 17 and 18, Solomon says, I applied myself to the understanding of wisdom and also of madness and folly, but I learned that this too is a chasing after the wind. You're going to hear that phrase numerous times. For with much wisdom comes much sorrow, the more knowledge, the more grief. And then this next verse, of making many books, there is no end, and much study wearies the body. And I know this academic year didn't end as you expected it to end, but I'm sure there are those out there today who still remember pulling a few all-nighters to finish those class projects or cramming for finals. And you just heard Solomon say, much study wearies the body. And what do you say? Copy that, Solomon. You remember what that's like. And again, Solomon isn't saying that we shouldn't learn. I think what he's saying is that everything we need to learn can't be learned from books and can't be learned in the classroom. Solomon is just suggesting that the pursuit of God's wisdom is much more beneficial than man's knowledge. So to the graduates today and everyone else listening, I want to remind you that we have the greatest textbook of all in our library as Christians. It's God's Word. Someone said of God's Word, there's a big difference in the books that men make and the book that makes men. And that's so true. James said in James 1, verse 5, if any of you lacks wisdom, he should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to him. Solomon's pursuit of human knowledge just left him empty, and it can do the same thing for you and me. Remember that it's not so much about a diploma or a degree, as good as those things can be, but it's more about to what degree you and I are placing our faith in God and how we're walking with the Lord. So Solomon says wisdom is more valuable than education. A second lesson that Solomon learned, and we need to learn it as well, is that joy lasts longer than pleasure. We see this in chapter 2. Solomon pursued every imaginable pleasure. Believe it or not, chapter 2 identifies some of the biggest areas of pleasure that we're also tempted to pursue. And remember, this book was written 3,000 years ago. What are the things that Solomon pursued? Oddly enough, Solomon turned to humor to find pleasure. In Ecclesiastes 2, verse 2, we read, "Laughter, I said, is foolish, and what does pleasure accomplish?" You see, humor certainly has its place. Solomon says in another book that he wrote, the book of Proverbs, that a cheerful heart does good like medicine. It's good to laugh. It's medicinal. I like to make people laugh. I like to tell jokes. It's tough to tell jokes in an empty auditorium. So last week we added this laugh track, and you just heard thunderous laughter after those two great jokes that I told. Now my daughter-in-law Sadie was at our house the other night and said, "Mike, I've got a joke that I think can get more laughs than yours does." I said, "Well, tell me the joke and we'll see." So we're going to give her her moment here in our worship service today. She said the other night, she said, "Mike, I had this crazy dream." I said, "What's that?" She said, "I dreamed I was a muffler." I said, "Well, that is crazy. What was it like?" And she said, "Well, I don't know, but I woke up the next morning just exhausted." Okay, Sadie, you win. You're the winner. By the way, we're going to bring this laugh track back to church. Even when we start gathering in person again, it just makes me funnier. But anyway, in Ecclesiastes, Solomon says there's a time and a season for everything, including what? A time to laugh. But listen, laughter is not the end all. Laughter brings enjoyment. But of course, it should never be at someone else's expense, or it shouldn't be offensive to God. And beyond that, laughter shouldn't become a mask or a mechanism to prevent other people from seeing us for who we really are and for knowing how we really feel. There will be well-intentioned people in this life say that you just got to put on a happy face and get through that, that you just need to laugh your way through life. But the Bible never ever says that laughter is to be an escape. That same passage says there's a time to laugh, but there's also a time to weep. But that's something Solomon tried. Solomon also turned to the excessive use of alcohol to find pleasure. In Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verse 3, Solomon says, "I tried cheering myself with wine and embracing folly, my mind still guiding me with wisdom. I wanted to see what was worthwhile for man to do under heaven," notice, "during the few days of their lives." When I was a kid, a popular beer distributor used this marketing slogan that says, "You only go around once in life, so grab for all the gusto that you can." That kind of sounds like Solomon's philosophy of life, at least for a little while during his life. And I don't want to be preachy this morning. I don't want to lecture anyone. I just want to sound this alarm that this life's short, party-hard way of living can bring some awful consequences that can haunt you and even others for years to come. Temporary pleasure can quickly turn to long-term pain. If you don't believe me, ask the addict or ask the one who lost a loved one at the hands of an impaired driver. I came across this counsel this week, and I really like it, where it says, "You only live once, so think twice." Every morning I read Max Lucado's devotions called Upwards, And it's amazing how on any particular day he has something that just really speaks to me. And this past week on Tuesday and Wednesday, he really said some things that will apply to the message that I'm bringing today. On Tuesday, he entitled it, Choose What Pleases God. He says, years ago, a friend gave me this counsel. Make a list of all the lives you would impact through this particular act of immorality. All Lucado is saying is, you just live once, so think twice. And I know we're not as intentional as that, where we stop at that temptation and we list all the people that might be hurt by that. But I think we need to be intentional. Lucado says, this list reminds me that one act of carnality is a poor exchange for a lifetime of lost legacy. So do what pleases God. And then the next day he came right back with a devotion and said, actions have consequences. Make this your rule of thumb. Do what pleases God. He quotes Psalm 4, verse 5, where he says, do what is right as a sacrifice to the Lord. And then he just closes with this counsel, you will never go wrong doing what is right. We just live once, but let's think twice. Well, Solomon then turns to work and things to find pleasure. We'll come back to that in just a moment. But in Ecclesiastes 2, verse 4, he had all the latest gadgets. He had everything that he wanted. All he had to do was say the word, and it was done. Verse 7 tells us he had female servants and male servants. Verse 8 tells us he had men and women singers. He didn't need a stereo because he had a live band wherever he wanted it. Solomon also had all the sensual pleasures that a boy could imagine. And to parents out there, I'm going to be careful what I say here. But in Ecclesiastes 2, verse 8, Solomon says, I acquired a harem as well, the delights of a man's heart. According to 1 Kings 11, Solomon had 1,000 women at his disposal, 700 wives and 300 concubines, or as one youngster called it, 300 porcupines. And that may be a little closer to truth because regardless, it's going to be a sticky situation. Chuck Swindoll says, 1,000 women, absolutely unbelievable. They were available to Solomon any time of the day or night to fulfill whatever sensual desire he had. Yet his boredom couldn't be described. He ran out of words to say it. It simply came back to futility. Even Solomon found that pursuit to be completely empty. Well, after a life lived outside the moral boundaries that God had established, I want you to listen to what Solomon learned from this immorality. We see this in Ecclesiastes chapter 2, verses 10 and 11. He said, I denied myself nothing my eyes desired. I refused my heart no pleasure. My heart took delight in all my work, and this was the reward for all my labor. He continues, yet when I surveyed all that my hands had done and what I had toiled to achieve, everything was meaningless, a chasing after the wind. There's that phrase again. Nothing was gained under the sun. Fun for the moment, pleasure for the moment, but no lasting joy, just meaningless activity, a chasing after the wind. You ever chase something of little value? The other day, Cassie and I were going to Dollar General, and we had our mask ready for once we went inside, and I just hung my mask over one ear. I wasn't going to put it all the way on until I got inside the store, and the wind was really blowing that day, and it blew my mask off my ear, and it started moving across the parking lot, and I began to chase this mask. This story ought to come with a video. I'd lean down, try to pick it up. The wind would blow it further. I'd lean down, try to pick it up. The wind would blow it further, and all this time, my loving wife is behind me just laughing hysterically. She believes that laughter is good medicine. There was even a stranger who had joined Cassie in laughing at me. In fact, when I finally did catch the mask, I came back and this woman who didn't even know me said this. She had her mask on and she said, well, at least you got your exercise for today. Now, I'll never be able to recognize her, but I will remember those eyes as she spoke that to me. Chasing after a mask that really cost me nothing when I had another mask in the truck that I could have went and got. Do we chase things that don't matter? Are you chasing things that won't satisfy? Solomon did. Another lesson that Solomon learned and we learn from him is that significance is better than success. Let me say this to anyone who is listening, whether you're a graduate or not. Too many people define themselves by what they do for a living. When you attend your high school reunion, or when you're seated on a bus or an airplane next to a stranger, oftentimes conversations open up with this statement. So, what do you do for a living? And there's nothing necessarily wrong with that, but if we're not careful, this can become a subtle system of measuring the success of someone else by what it is that they do. And of course, we do the math, what it is they might earn for doing that. I mean, we're just immersed in a culture that's fixated on climbing the ladder of success. But the problem is, when we get to the top of the wall, we often discover that it leads to nowhere. Or once we get there, we find out that we're all alone. And that's what Solomon experienced. In Ecclesiastes 4, verse 4, we read this, "And I saw that all labor and all achievement spring from man's envy of his neighbor. This too is meaningless, a chasing after the wind." Later in verse 8, he would write this, "There was no end to his toil, and yet his eyes were not content with his wealth. He asked, 'For whom am I toiling, and why am I depriving myself of enjoyment? This too is meaningless, a miserable business.'" You know, Solomon asks a good question, doesn't he? Who am I doing this for, really? You see, the person who puts success instead of significance on the pedestal is oftentimes driven by what others think of them rather than what God thinks of them. And they never grow out of it. In fact, they tend to pass that on to their children. And again, I'm not saying that success is wrong. I'm not saying that we shouldn't excel and do well. I just think this is important, that too many people find their self-worth through professional achievement. They emphasize what they do, not who they are. It's more about doing than it is about becoming, like Michael W. Smith talks about in his song. Listen, my chosen profession is ministry, and I love what I do, but that's not who I am. My true value and your true value comes from the fact we belong to God. And to the graduates today, I want you to know that more than anything, you matter to God. You do. But He wants your life to matter. He wants you to use your life to make a significant difference in this world where He has placed you. So I'm lovingly challenging you today to make your life count by making sure that God can count on you. Another lesson that Solomon learned, and a lesson that we need to learn, is this, that people are more important than possessions. See, I think the truth is, people matter most to God, so people should matter most to us. It was Spencer Kimball who said, "Love people, not things. Use things, not people." But unfortunately, we sometimes have that backwards. We love things and we use people. But understand today that God created us for community. We are relational beings. We need people, and people need us. Solomon speaks to the importance of meaningful relationships in Ecclesiastes 4, where he says, "Two are better than one, because they have a good return for their work. If one falls down, his friend can help him up. But pity the man who falls and has no one to help him. Also, if two lie down together, they'll keep warm. But how can one keep warm alone? Though one may be overpowered, two can defend themselves, and a cord of three strands is not easily or quickly broken." Solomon saw the value of relationships, but Solomon also had great wealth. We read this in verses 7 and 8, "I also owned more herds and flocks than anyone in Jerusalem before me. I amassed silver and gold for myself and the treasure of kings and provinces." He goes on to say in chapter 5, "Whoever loves money never has money enough. Whoever loves wealth is never satisfied with his income. This too is meaningless. As goods increase, so do those who consume them." And what benefit are they to the owner except to feast his eyes on them? The sleep of a laborer is sweet, whether he eats little or much, but the abundance of a rich man permits him no sleep. Solomon talks about the futility of riches. And sometimes we place more emphasis on things than we do on people and how we treat them and how we relate to them. And you know, as adults, we can accuse young people of being so into things, but I wonder, where did they learn that from? We may never say it out loud, but our actions may suggest otherwise. Jesus gives us this warning in Luke 12, verse 15, where he says, "Watch out, be on your guard against all kinds of greed." And then he says this, that a man's life does not consist in the abundance of his possessions. You see, relationships are always more important than resources, and that's a lesson that we need to learn now. And I don't know about you, but this pandemic has taught us a lot of things. But I think one thing that it's taught me, and I hope it's teaching you this too, that we need to hold on loosely to our things, to our possessions, but we need to hold on much more tightly to the relationships we have with the people we love and the people that God has placed in our lives. Last lesson, I promise. And this is the most important lesson that Solomon learned. And I believe it's the most important lesson that we need to learn. That faith is more important than anything. You see, when we're young, our priorities are based on limited information and life experience. I mean, we struggle with what's most important, and having a crisis of identity is sort of commonplace. I mean, you're trying to find your place in this world and you're establishing your beliefs. There's this tug of war taking place because we mistakenly seek the acceptance of others rather than the approval of God. But especially to the young people who are listening in today, this is a pattern that I hope you will break early on. If not, it could become the norm in your adult years. And I think the same is true with your spiritual relationship with God. You see, at the end of the day, Solomon determines that faith in God is our greatest asset and resource. It's the one constant in this life that we can count on. So he concludes his dissertation on the futility of finding joy and fulfillment in this life, and he summarizes what he's learned since his quote-unquote high school days. He says this in Ecclesiastes 12, verses 13 and 14. "Now all has been heard. Here's the conclusion of the matter." That's Solomon saying, at the end of the day, here's what matters most. "Fear God and keep his commandments, for this is the whole duty of man. For God will bring every deed into judgment, including every hidden thing, whether it's good or evil." Again, to the graduates today, I want to say this, that your faith in God and your walk with Christ needs to be your priority pursuit. And listen, it has to be your faith. It can't just be your parents' faith. It can't just be your church's faith or your pastor's faith or your youth minister's faith. It's got to be your faith, because your faith is going to be tested all throughout life. To the middle school graduates, your faith will be tested in high school, as there will be a whole new set of temptations waiting there for you. To the high school graduates, your faith will be tested in college or even the military by challenging this belief system that has guided you up until now. To the college graduate and those already in the workplace, your faith will also be tested. In fact, the data indicates that many of you will walk away from the church and you'll abandon your faith. My encouragement to you, and I have a lot of confidence in you, prove the data wrong. Be the exception. Show the world that faith is the most important thing in your life, that it's what guides you, it's what drives you, it's what gives you strength. As some of us can attest to, there will be times in this life when it seems like all you have is your faith, because circumstances of this life just seem to strip everything else away from us. So I just need to ask this question to everyone who's listening today. As it stands right now with your faith, answer this question. When all you have is your faith, will it be enough? When you place your faith and all of your weight into the hands of Christ and our Heavenly Father, I believe it will be. So my encouragement is to properly tend your faith, nurture it, grow it, allow God to test it, allow God to strengthen it, make it your primary pursuit. Well, as I close, the good news is that Solomon returned to revering God, and he chronicled his experiences for us to read, hoping to prevent us from wasting our lives on temporary pleasures that just don't bring lasting satisfaction. They don't bring meaning or purpose to our lives. And it's like we're returning to where we started. It's almost as though Solomon is saying, if I knew then what I know now. Solomon wasn't afforded the right to go back and to change anything. And we don't always get do-overs either, do we? But here's one thing that I do know for sure. We have but one life to live, and how we live it and who we live it for makes all the difference in this world and the next. With God's grace and by Christ's help, we have one chance to get it right. I used to tell this little joke about a guy who went to buy a car. He's test driving the car. The salesman's in the car with him. As they pull away from the lot, the salesman looks at the guy and says, you know, this car is the opportunity of a lifetime. And the guy looks back at the salesman and says, well, it must be, because it's been knocking ever since we left the lot. Yeah, I know, that's not even worthy of the laugh track, is it? But you know, sometimes opportunity does just knock once. We have one chance to get it right. I want to use a reading to close out my challenge to you today, but also to prepare you and your family for a time of communion. It's a poem that reads old, but I love what it has to say. It's called Only One Life. Two little lines I heard one day, traveling along life's busy way, bringing conviction to my heart and from my mind would not depart. Only one life, 'twill soon be past, and only what's done for Christ will last. Only one life, yes, only one, soon will its fleeting hours be done. Then in that day, my Lord to meet and stand before His judgment seat. Only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Only one life, the still small voice gently pleads for a better choice, bidding me selfish aims to leave and to God's holy will to cleave. Only one life, 'twill soon be past, and only what's done for Christ will last. Only one life, a few brief years, each with its burdens, hopes, and fears, each with its days I must fulfill, living for self or in His will. Only one life, 'twill soon be past, and only what's done for Christ will last. And when this bright world would tempt me sore, when Satan would a victory score, when self would seek to have its way, then help me, Lord, with joy to say, only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. Give me, Father, a purpose deep, in joy or sorrow Thy word to keep, faithful and true whate'er the strife, pleasing Thee in my daily life. For only one life, 'twill soon be past, and only what's done for Christ will last. Oh, let my love with fervor burn, and from the world now let me turn, living for Thee and Thee alone, bringing Thee pleasure on Thy throne. Only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. And it closes, only one life, yes, only one. Now let me say, Thy will be done, and when at last I'll hear the call, I know I'll say, 'twas worth it all. Only one life, 'twill soon be past. Only what's done for Christ will last. I'll offer up a prayer, and then you and your family can partake of the Lord's Supper together. Let's pray. God, we're thankful for this one life that You've given us, a life that You intended for us to live for You and for Your glory, to walk with Christ and to be faithful to Him. So God, guide us as we do this, and as we take a moment now to remember what Christ has done for us. We're thankful that He had but one life to give, and He was willing to give that life for us. So we thank You for His body which was broken, His blood that was shed. We remember what He's done for us, and I pray this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. I want to thank you for joining us for online worship on this Memorial Day weekend. And if you call FCC your church home, we've been encouraging you each week that another important aspect of our worship is through the giving of our tithes and our offerings to support the ministry of our church. So I just want to encourage you to remain faithful in these uncertain times in your giving. And we also do this thing at FCC called Change for a Dollar, where we just encourage families that can to give an extra dollar or two to help meet benevolent needs inside the church family and outside the church family also. So if you can help with that, we would appreciate it as well. And you might know that we've been collecting some funds for Vivert and Neelam Law, who are serving in their home country of India. And they're trying to help wage workers and their families who are being impacted by COVID-19. And I am so excited to announce to you today that because of your generosity, our church is going to be able to present the laws with $1,500 to help feed these hungry families. So thanks for that. We appreciate it so much. And I want to invite you back next weekend for online worship. I'm going to start a new sermon series called Confidence in Uncertain Times. And we're going to spend all of our time in 2 Corinthians chapters 3, 4, and 5. And I'd love to have you join us for this study. You know, the Bible says to honor those to whom honor is due. And on this Memorial Day weekend, we remember and honor our loved ones who have gone on before us. But we also have opportunity to honor another special group. That's our veterans. That's the men and women who even currently are serving in our armed forces. So we honor you today. And I wish we could do this in a big auditorium and have you stand, but we just want you to know how much we appreciate your sacrifice and your service. And I think one way that we can honor you is to honor the flag under which you serve. So I'm just going to ask that wherever you are right now, in your living room or kitchen, if you would just stand with me, and if you just face your screen, there'll be a flag there in just a moment. And if you'd take off your hat, if you're wearing one, if you'd just take your hand and place it over your heart, I want to lead you in the reciting of the Pledge of Allegiance. Let's do this together. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thanks for joining me in that. You can have a seat if you'd like to, but I just want you to watch this short video that we're about to show. And this is simply being done to honor those that when the call came in, you said yes.
Extraordinary men and women went before us with unmatched resilience, enduring hardship, when called upon to defend and liberate. They said yes. They found courage to rise with every sun, loyalty toward their country, discipline for every command. Even in the darkest hours, they said yes. They cherished and fought for freedom, so those coming behind them were assured of it. And when the moment came for them to give it all, their futures never to be written, they said, yes. Today, we think upon their sacrifice and find our way to honor them. Saying yes to making the most of what they gave us and filling the earth with God's goodness. We thank them for their yes. They will never be forgotten.